Bazaar is intended for mature, open-minded audiences only. If you are easily offended, we suggest you turn this wacky shit straight off.
Oh, yeah.
So funny.
Wow. I feel like we're hearing what it's like when Lyle jerks off, you know?
Oh, it's entertaining.
Do I sound all old timey?
Yeah, man. I mean, yes, you do.
But how do we sound to you?
But never stop.
All right, fellas.
You couldn't possibly sound worse. What the fuck? I don't. It's so hilarious to me that in this day and age, the technology can work just enough to sound that bad. Like, give us a little something there, John Mark.
Well, you see, I'm traveling home from work, and I'm connected to this here Mazda.
It's a little tin, yeah.
Traveling west on the Oregon Trail.
You're saying?
Exactly. Don't die of dysentery.
Okay, well.
And ford the river.
So John Mark's on his way home. And
bad version of Oregon Trail.
He'll join us when he can join us. As long as you can hear us, John Mark, you don't really... I mean, you weigh in if you need to, but only if you need to. Because, that's as bad as I've ever heard anything on any modern recording of all time. Anywho, wow, it feels like it's been a long-ass time. I guess it kind of has. And
How was your birthday?
My birthday was yesterday, and I did the hell out of my birthday, and I'm a little
good.
I'm a little hungover and drunk.
Oh man,
again,
my boy. So yeah, still drunk. I love it.
I may be partially still drunk and then drunk again. Yeah, that sort of thing. So the night should prove interesting. I only have one news story. Then I brought a game. I felt like I needed some sort of redemption because. I had a lot of fun giving you guys the video game quz last week.
I liked
the last episode.
I'm sorry I busted your ball so much. I just thought it was some of those tracks. I was like, man, these are deep ass cuts, and I respect that.
Well,
I wanted the softballs.
You did way better than anyone. The average feedback that I was seeing was people were getting one or less correct. Now here's what I should have done. I should have, I stand by my cuts, but I should have given you a multiple choice. And so tonight we're going to be doing horror movie quotes. Now I know we're not quite in Oktoberdo, but I think a lot of us, as soon as that Mercury stops pegging in the upper reds, starts dropping a bit, and especially those evenings get a little cooler, we all start thinking about spooky time stuff, and I'm jumping the gun. Mm-hmm. I always jump the gun on spooky time shit, so we're going to do a little horror movie quote quiz. I originally was going to do this sort of like we did the last quiz with audio clips, but it just wasn't coming across very well, so this will just be the quotes themselves, but I am going to give you a multiple choice, and I ran this by Sarah and her friend Amanda. Both pretty good horror fans. They did pretty good with it. So I'm hoping it's not too easy, but you never know. We'll see. Either way, we'll be talking about horror movies, and I have one news story that I want to get to, but it sounded to me like Chris needed to get a story off his chest before we really get rolling. I have no idea what this is, but you needed to be...
I got a couple, man. It's been an interesting couple of weeks for me.
Okay.
I want to start it off by saying... It seems like just yesterday, I sheepishly came on this podcast and told you all I was going to be a dad. Mm-hmm. It was 5 years ago. And as of last week, I have a fucking kindergartner, man.
That's it's crazy.
Fucking weird. It's wild, so
it?
Fucking
in, officially
weird.
In the system.
Yep. Officially in the system. And I just wanted to share a story about day one. So... let's see. So Bridget's mom lives right across the street from the school he's going to, which is great, except he can't walk home by himself. He has to take a bus to, like a after school care and a before school care, because we both work, you know?
Yeah.
So we both took his first day off from work. And the reasoning behind that was we knew we might be a little emotional, and we wanted to be available in case the teacher called and was like, yo, he's having a meltdown, because we just didn't know how it was going to go, you know? He's a good kid. He likes to be social. He likes that stuff, but he also gets really shy, and he's very sensitive. I don't know where he gets these from.
Mm-hmm.
but so we took the day off, and the idea was after we drop him off at school, we were just going to drink mimosas and play games together and kind of process the day.
You and the kid.
And yeah, me and the kid. Me yeah. and his mom. And so we go drop him off at school, and we're not even allowed in the classroom. Like, we walk him to the classroom door, we give him a hug, he walks in. That's the best. That was awesome, because I was worried about him wanting to leave us, you know?
Yeah.
But the teacher just took him right in.
Yeah.
And that was great.
Not an
so
option.
We're walking back to Bridget's house to load up her car to go to my house, because I have two screens set up for games and the champagne, the important stuff. Mm-hmm. And we're like kind of a little weepy, and we're like, can you believe we got this kid to kindergarten and yada yada? And we're just like in awe that we're here. And we load, this 5 minutes after we've dropped him off, we load everything in the car. She lets her dog out, and the dog's going to go jump in my car too, because the dog comes with her. Dog's great. Love the dog. And the dog goes to get in my car, hears something, bolts right into the street, and gets hit by a fucking car.
Oh, no.
Dog rolls in the street. I have my arms full of shit. I'm like, And Bridget's like, my dog just got hit by a fucking car. And I was like, I can't believe this happened. Dog jumps up out of the street, runs over to us. Big old, she's a pit bull. She's a big girl.
Okay.
And she's breathing really heavily, but she seems to be okay. So we put her in my car, and we're watching her. And we're driving. My house is 5 minutes away. And in that five-minute trip, immediately something, we could tell something's wrong. Because that dog is putting a smell off of it that I have never fucking smelled before. It smelled like her pheromones or hormones or some shit were just going nuts.
Uh-huh.
Like she was in shock. And like it smelled like the wettest dog I've ever seen, smelled. We get the dog to my house, pull her inside. She throws up 7 times.
Oof.
Just throwing up all over the place. And I'm like, are you taking this dog to the vet or what? And Bridget's like, she called them and they're like, well, what we're going to want to do is the scan. And, you know, this is the amount of money you're looking at.
Yeah.
And it's like, fuck, man, I don't know what to do here. Like, it's like $3,000 is what they're going to want to charge me for this. And I can't tell what's happening. I'm like, well, I respect your decision. Why don't we like chill out for a couple hours and see how we do? 2 hours later, dog wakes up from a nap like nothing ever fucking happened.
Wow.
But man, that was a fucking dicey few hours. Let me tell you, we were
scary.
that
happened to Max.
Yeah, I remember Max getting hit.
We were at a friend's house, and he was just out fucking around, and he was with the neighborhood dog running the fence, you know, and I yelled at him to come over. I said, get over here, Max, and he comes running over. And, you know, this is a pretty rural neighborhood for the most part. There's hardly anybody driving on this road. And as shit, some fucking old dude starts just cruising like 40, you know, in a 20, 25-mile-an-hour street, hits him, knocks him back like, I want to say 3 or 4 car lengths into my buddy's truck, into his bumper. I mean, he hit that with some force. So not only did he get hit by the car, he also, you know, basically ended up hitting a bumper to stop him, knocked the shit out of him. And I ran to him and I kind of, you know, stood over the top of him. And he's just looking at me like, whoa, dude.
Yeah.
You know, he's still alive. He's still conscious. And he's happy to see me. You know, he's on his back with his paws, you know, up, you know, in on him and just looking at me like, what the fuck just happened, Dad? And, you know, the guy was like, hey, is there anything I could do? I said, yeah, get the fuck out of here as fast as you can.
Give me everything in your
just
wallet.
Get the fuck out of here. Yeah. Dude, you ready to get your ass beat? Go. You know, and then he took off and he was luckily fine. But I mean, by all means, it's scary as hell. You know,
oh, yeah. I don't know if you guys, Chris, did you ever, you couldn't have known Ruka, That was before your time. Lyle might remember.
I don't think
Ruka.
So. Yeah.
It was the dog that Lisa, my first wife, and I had. She got hit by a car. She escaped and got hit by a car, and I didn't know what the fuck was. She just showed up back at the house. I'm like, oh, there you are, you little shit. Get inside. And she's laying under the tree, like, not looking right. And I'm like, uh-oh. And she starts swelling up like a fucking giant hot dog.
Ugh, no.
She She was fucked up. We took her to emergency surgery, and they, you know, she was there for about 4 or 5 days. Pretty touch and go. She did need surgery. She got all kinds of fucked up. But they saved her, and she pulled through and lived another, I think, 4 or 5 years after that. So, fucking crazy. So nothing, how long ago was it that the dog got hit?
This was a week ago.
Okay,
There was some, like, a little bit of blood in her throw up and stuff, and we were like, fuck, dude, that's, like, internal bleeding, but it's just a tiny little bit. We think she has, so Bridget told me, I didn't see it, I just heard it. Bridget told me she thinks the dog actually hit the car and not the other way around, like, she ran full fucking speed into the street and hit the side of the car as it was, and thank God, because it's like a 40 mile an hour street, so people are flying down it.
Oh, for sure.
But yeah, dog's fine, and we're really grateful. But man, that was a harrowing.
I'm really glad that had a happy ending. Told Logan,
cause,
it's like, man, we're starting off with dogs getting run over.
I just
stories.
Couldn't fucking believe it. I had one other tale I wanted to share with you. What'd you say?
I said, but all three of our stories ended happily. I mean, the dogs survived.
Yeah, thank God, right?
Yeah, no, Max is
fine.
Afterwards.
Yeah.
I did something I'd never done before. Somebody invited me down to Coos Bay, Oregon, to go to the dunes there. Mm-hmm. Have you guys ever been down there?
Yep.
I know, Lyle, you probably haven't, but I've never been. I've never seen those dunes.
I've been in parts of Oregon, but not down there.
Okay. It's like big old sand dunes right on the beach there.
Yeah.
And people bring they call them side-by-sides. I was like, oh, dune buggies. The person that brought me was like, don't call them dune buggies. That's like
that's
ancient.
And I was
like,
okay, cool. Around here.
But
that's like calling
we went camping
indigenous
up there with
Indians.
Yeah, totally. It was. And we went camping up there, and we took a couple of my friends, and I had a really fucking great weekend. It was, something I never experienced before. It felt like I got to ride in the side-by-sides a couple of times. It was like being on a roller coaster on those dunes.
Yeah.
Really, really fun. But I will tell you this, and there was a time, I'm all about personal growth. I think, we go back and listen to episodes of this podcast from 10 years ago, and we're like, oof, I don't really like the person I was, right? I really don't like those views I had. And I think I went through a period during the last presidential administration where I really, really didn't like anyone that supported Trump. Like, I had a hard time embracing that.
Yeah.
And I moved past that. It's been my goal in the last couple of years to kind of not take politics so personally because people get so fucking wrapped up in them. And I don't want to be that person. Like, I know good people can like Trump, you know? But I just don't like him so much that it really taints my point of view.
Yeah.
So I've been trying to be more open-minded about that stuff. And so,
good.
As you can imagine, this is a very, very white group of people that do this. It's not a very diverse group. Does it make sense? Like,
sure.
I don't think I saw a single person of color the whole time I was there, and I saw hundreds of people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, as you can imagine, lots of "Let's go Brandon" flags on these side by sides. Lots of Trump flags and stuff. And the person that brought me was like, you should really consider buying one of these side-by-sides. How fun would that be? And I was like, it would be fun. And I'll tell you what, if I get one, I'm getting like a butter emails flag or something to fly just to make conversation when I get up here. And they're like, oh God, don't call a dune buggy. Don't get a fucking Hillary
Clinton
flag.
Don't put a Clinton flag in there.
Like, okay, I won't.
I was like, you know, trying to get a cut on the beach, bro.
they do
no shit, right?
Well, you know, they've been doing that for years out at Moses Lake. Moses,
the potholes.
Yeah, sand dunes and everything out there. And that's what they do. They go out there and just get all fucked up.
It looks fun, but it is some white person shit. White people, see, this is the thing. This is
a white person thing.
This is why it's a white person thing, is because we have had it too easy. So we have to go out of our ways to invent these recreational things that could take us off of the earth.
Dude, and let me tell you,
other people's like, look, I got some real persecution and shit to deal with. Y'all honkies can have fun with your side by sides and your flag wars. I'm convinced.
I always wanted one for hunting. We
saw a wreck that actually had the police come and ambulances. Like a young girl, a child, I think, was ejected from fold, and we broke her arm in 5 places. And they had to cart her off, and the dude that was driving got arrested for DUI.
Oh, yeah.
Not part of the group I was with or anything. But I do want to say also, when I say personal growth and, you know, maybe learning to mingle with people that you don't
you disagree
normally with.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think one of them. Okay, hold on. My kid's screaming. Mm-hmm. I got to for a sec. Sorry. Okay. Just a sec.
You know, those side by sides, they look and feel pretty safe, but.
Yeah, for the most part. I mean, they're tall, and that's the problem with them. They're like a Jeep. Mm-hmm. You know, when you get a lifted up Jeep, you know, so they're really unstable.
Yeah, tip heavy.
But they're fun as fuck. I wanted to get one for bow hunting or for, you know, just standard hunting because.
They're so loud, though.
Kind of sick.
Wouldn't you chase
off? No, not always. A lot of them are four strokes, you know, so they're just gas. Yeah. And so they're just like a blah, 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 blah. You know, from a distance. A lot of times when you shoot a deer or an elk or something like that, you're shooting at a distance anyway. You know, it's just to get them to the road is the problem. So what you do is get a side-by-side, get you closer, at least, you know, up to the deer or elk. You could quarter them up and then strap them up and then get your you know, side-by-side to your truck.
Yeah.
You know, through the final.
I know so many people that have been seriously injured trying to pull a deer. I mean, forget an elk, just even trying to pull a deer out of wherever you killed it, and that's tough work. Are you gonna
by yourself? You got really hard.
You all set up to do some hunting this season? It's coming up, right? Where are we?
Equip wise, equip wise, I am, but I'd love to have a side by side or something like that. Would be great.
You get yourself some venison or elk.
I have friends that hunt by horse. Burgers. Well, I have friends that hunt by horse, and I think typically the.
Like straight up, they're on the horse.
That seems ideal if you can
standard
do it.
And then the people that have a lot of money, dude, those are $20,000, $30,000 rigs you're looking at. Those side by sides, they're expensive.
They're to buy more one than
strictly
that
for hunting. Yeah.
That's the low end.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, they are they're street legal, aren't they? I mean, you can make them street legal.
Some of them are. Most of them are.
So that would be cheap for a car these days.
One of the things I experienced though, I literally sat around a campfire with a bunch of people who really enjoy their firearms, which is fine. But then one of them gave a lecture to us on who was the most efficient mass shooter and why. And I was just like, my God,
that's not a
mass shooter.
That's not a top 10 that's list just, anyone should be.
No, I was like, oh my God.
Who won? Do you remember?
That's just
It was the Vegas shooter, and he had lots of reasons.
Of course.
Like, oh my God!
Well, wasn't that the most?
Not just the kill count, but deadliest? His efficiency and how he got the weapons there, and what the position he was set up in. I'm like, Jesus, too much fucking thought into this, man.
Yeah, that's the bad goosebumps. That gives you the bad goosebumps. Yeah. But one thing that Christopher said that I liked, one thing he said was the trying to
only one.
You don't have to. You don't have to try to see things from somebody else's perspective. You don't have to try to hear them out. It's just accepting. Mm-hmm. I do believe that we have, and it's always been this way in person. I think that a lot of us have more in common than we ever want to admit. But social media has made it so much easier to just be cunts to each other, and that division is so toxic, and it only. It only serves to rile up the, like, if you don't like what this side is doing, what do you think constantly poking them with sticks and in calling them names? And I'm guilty of this as much as anybody, but what do you think that ultimately does to that side? Does it calm things down? Is that a de-escalation, or is it provoking somebody or some entity or some group into a more extreme mentality and therefore maybe a more extreme event? And I think that's something that we all could probably take with us a little bit more, just keeping in mind that we're all humans breathing the same air and the same planet, and it's crazy for everybody. I don't care what your upbringing is, this life is wacky. And we get so fucking, it's so easy to just be like, no, this person is dead to me, they're my enemy no matter what. But it's not like that. It really isn't like that. It's really easy to get into that mindset with social media, but personal relationships
I was
a whole
totally
different thing.
It, unfortunately, I
well, I am too.
I was getting into fights with strangers online, and even people I knew
It triggers something.
Just wasn't where I wanted to be.
You know, social media has, this is not an accident. None of this is an accident. You know, just knowing what the word algorithm means, we have been played, and I don't, you know, not going into like all conspiracy theory. It doesn't have to go into conspiracy theories. Like, we have been played to constantly, like, there could be one post that can get 10,000 comments on it. Somebody is cashing that all the way to the bank. And meanwhile, everyone else is getting ramped up and everyone else is like getting paranoid and, you know, and it can affect election outcomes. It can affect a whole bunch of shit. It can lead to violence in real life. It can lead to the end of relationships in real life. Family not talking to each other anymore. No one gives a shit about that. None of these companies that have provided this outlet that will steer you towards seeing things that will likely make you engage. Well, what makes us engage more than something that, like, ooh, you know, the stupidest thing that I see happening now. It's like they never run out of tricks. And the trick that I see happening now is not tied to this kind of thing. It's like there'll be, maybe you guys have seen this, there'll be some sort of pop culture post. And it'll have a picture of like five well-known celebrities when they're young. And it'll be like, oh, there's Ralph Macchio and so-and-so and so-and-so. But they won't name the fifth one on purpose, even though the fifth one might be the most famous out of them all. Knowing full well that everyone's going to be like, what about a young Jennifer Aniston there back in the Mickey Mouse days or whatever the fuck? It's like, I have noticed this over and over and over again. And I only noticed it because somebody in the comments is like, what is this bullshit? This is the new thing now. And it took someone else pointing it out to me. I was like, and since I've had that pointed out to me, I see it all the fucking time. It's like, here's a lineup of famous people. 1, 2, 3, and 4. What about 5? You missed the fifth. It's just this stupid call to action that gets you to weigh in, and all of a sudden it's just a bunch of comments, and they sell those comments to whatever. You know, it's all being sold. These are all sponsored posts, and they're all for marketing and whatever, collecting. Anyway.
Data.
Yeah, it's the ever-present data. But the social media machine is ruining us on so many levels, and it's so hard to fight because these algorithms know what will light up our brain in a way that we have to actually stop and take a deep breath and fight it, because it's just like this. You know when you're fighting, well, you know when you're arguing with somebody that you know really well and you know what buttons to push? Like, if you're really pissed at them, you know where to go if you want them to just be like, This is what the algorithms basically do. And it's not always in the negative end of the spectrum, but it usually is, because that gets a more visceral reaction. It can also be in the positive thing, or even something stupid like, well, you forgot about Jennifer. How could you name all these other famous celebrities? I'm going to get in here and fix this problem. Not realizing that, oh, this was a setup, and now I've commented, and so have 500 other people commented, like, what about Jennifer Aniston?
Well, a lot of things, too, is stupid. That a lot of that is interconnected. So, like, typically, like Google, if you're using Google, you're Googling up something. Say you needed, say you need a new coffee pot. So you're like, oh, I need a new coffee pot. I'm going to go to Amazon, check it out, see what they got. I want one that has an espresso machine on it because, you know, I love coffee. So I go there, and then I go, you know, to Google, and then I go to Facebook. And then all of a sudden, my Facebook is pumping all these coffee pot ads in my background.
Yeah.
And you're like, how does it know I need coffee, you know, a coffee pot, you know? And it's just, it's like that, but with everything, you know what I mean?
Did so I tell you guys that I did this experiment?
There's no escape.
Sometimes I forget what I've actually brought and what I'm still working on, but I've been working on testing all of the shit that I'm surrounded by saying random things that normally, like if you search for something on Google, that's going to pop up everywhere.
Phillips screwdriver. No. Phillips screwdriver, like 3 times.
It was orange bungee cord. That's what I kept saying. Orange bungee cord. I haven't bought a bungee cord since the 90s. Orange bungee cord. I had that, for whatever reason, that's what I decided to come up with. It took less than 2 days before I was seeing ads of bungee. Try this. And I feel like I remember we talked about this shit a long time ago, and I feel like I went
sometimes through, I see shit instantly.
Yeah, well, I was kind of surprised it took that long, but it
that day.
It try this at home. But you have to do, I mean, for it to really jump out, it has to be something that you normally wouldn't have searched. If you bought anything on Amazon, if you searched anything on Google, that's already out there. That doesn't count. Pick something that you would never have searched and start saying it. Just say it out loud in your living room. Say it out loud in front of your phone. See what happens. I think you'll have a similar experience where you will start seeing orange bungee cord ads.
Wow. I'm totally going to try this.
Dialed in.
If that fucking happens, wow. Just saying it out loud in a place where, like, you have an Alexa or your iPhone. Is that what you're
doing? I don't
like,
even have
like
an
that?
Alexa. Yeah, iPhone.
Yeah, no, there's no escape.
No, and I've heard a lot of other people doing this, you know, and it works every time. So I just wanted to prove it. But it there's something, you know, pick a thing. There's something really special about seeing your unique thing that you made up. Well, you didn't make it up. I mean, orange bungee cords exist, but bungee cords evolved. Listen, I didn't see blue bungee cords. I didn't see multi-packs of black bungee cords. I saw an ad that was created just for Ron W. Evans with a set of orange bungee cords. I got a screenshot of it.
This is fucking wild.
And I was going to do a couple other tests before I brought this, but it's a good enough time to pull that conversation up. I mean, it's not... There wasn't going to be a whole show of it, but I was going to do screenshots and you just test. Yeah, it took 2 days. Anyway, yeah, give it a shot. Let us know.
Crazy. I have a...
Oh, yeah, sorry, go ahead. You go.
I have a quick little what the fuck animal for you. We don't need to identify this one, but I want you, before you open this video, I want you all to think about the biggest slug you've ever seen in your life, like a standard slug. Think about the biggest slug you've ever seen.
Okay.
And then open this fucking video.
Can we have salt with us? A bag of salt?
Oh, I feel so horrible for when I was a kid and did the salt on the snail trick. Can you imagine how painful it was for that poor little creature? Okay, where's this coming?
It's a big pile of salt you need.
Where'd it's you... coming, it's
oh,
coming
it's
across
over
Messenger.
Messenger.
He's thick.
It's
oh my god!
Thick.
Holy shit!
It's the size of a cat.
Oh my god! And it's just like a regular.
Isn't that fucking crazy?
Slug?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a slug.
Oh, it's so cool looking, isn't it? Though it's like.
It looks like a whale.
That's what I was gonna say.
Yeah, it looks like a xenomorph's head.
It's like you can kind of appreciate the design of that
she
creature.
She pets it at one point. She like strokes it.
I would want to as well.
Oh,
he's like,
no.
Oh god!
How I feel about that.
They're getting bigger, and they're going to come back and pour acid all over us.
Yeah, this
once
is revenge,
enough,
bitch.
Like, okay,
yeah.
We're slowly getting bigger, huh?
Man.
Huh? Isn't that kind of neat?
Isn't
we're a foot
fucking
long
crazy?
Now. In a couple of years,
Vancouver, Canada.
I would freak the fuck out if I saw that in my yard, man.
What do you do?
I've seen some big slugs, but the biggest, I mean, big would have been like maybe 4 inches. 4 inches.
You know what I would do is I would make a giant ass maze out of salt and see if it could find its way out.
The reverse. The
good
reverse,
luck, so fucker. Christopher Sociopath Hart will be upstairs smoking dubs, watching and waiting.
Yeah. There's a,
you know what? Your saw from Saw, Chris.
You're like, wait till he gets to the roundabout. Yeah.
There's a death metal project called Slugge that is basically kind of a loose sort of humorous concept around this giant race of cosmic psychic mollusks that's waging war on all other species. And like the titles of the songs are like puns off of like other like classic like death metal and metal tracks, like slug puns, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
pretty great.
Well, that sounds good. Well, before we get on to our game, you guys had to have seen this Mexican alien mummy thing.
Yes, I was gonna bring this up. Wow. It's fucking and this is like, is this the Mexican government releasing this too?
It seems.
We've seen shit like this before that's been completely debunked.
Yeah, and
it's,
you know,
on all sorts of news sites though. It's like
this, it was NPR that I saw it on, not the Daily Mail. not weird news from HuffPost. It's NPR. Yep. It's everywhere. I'm just going to read a little bit of it. Not the whole story. Yeah, I don't know what to fucking think. And of course, skeptical, but it is interesting how this is coming down through some seemingly proper channels. So Mexico's Congress heard testimony from experts who study extraterrestrials on Tuesday, and the hearing started with a huge surprise. Jaime Maussan, or probably I.M.E. Maussan, I'm going to say Maussan because it's fancy, a self-described ufologist brought two caskets into the congressional chambers. As Maussan spoke, the two men uncovered the caskets to reveal two bodies. The corpses looked white and like stereotypical depictions of aliens. Big head, little body, three fingers. Maussan said they were found in Peru in 2017 and are estimated to be 1,000 years old. If they can prove that one thing, whatever this is made of, even if it's a fucking sculpture of some sort of fucking pumice, if this thing is really 1,000 years old in that depiction, that is worthy of a story. And one of the bodies apparently had been pregnant, he claimed. He says, these are not mummies. These are complete bodies that have not been manipulated. Speaking under oath, Maussan claimed the bodies were non-human. Maussan and others have presented similar cases about alleged alien remains in the past. Scientists have dismissed them as either ancient Peruvian mummies or manipulated mummies. During Tuesday's hearing, Jose de Jesus Zalza Benitez, a forensic, I think I actually probably got that pretty close, a forensic expert and a military doctor walked the Congress through scans of the alleged alien bodies. He claimed the alleged aliens had big brains and big eyes, which allowed for a wide stereoscopic vision. They lacked teeth, so they likely only drank and did not chew. It goes on to say a few more details, but that's the big and short of it.
Well, and didn't they say like they had eggs and stuff like that inside of them?
He said one of like them had been X-rays. Pregnant. Whatever.
Yeah. I heard that too.
They didn't elaborate on that.
Yeah, they showed X-rays of like little eggs inside the belly. Yeah. It was weird.
I don't know. Thoughts? I mean, it's...
I don't know. Weird.
It's too early to tell.
We'll see where it goes. It's sure fascinating when you see the photos and stuff. It's kind of turtle-y looking.
This just dropped today.
Well, and they're small, too. They're little tiny things.
Yeah. And I don't know. There's a lot of UFO and a lot of alien talk lately, and a lot of it's going uncovered, even by people like us. And so I thought we couldn't skip over this one, but we'll keep our big eyes
on. There was this story a long time ago of a good friend of mine that he passed away, but him and another buddy of mine were in an orchard close to his house up by the airport, and there was they were out shooting crow or something like that for the orchard, and they stumbled across what it looked like to be like a little leaf man. And had been like, I don't know, 6 inches in height. And it looked like a pile of leaves until they approached it. It noticed that they saw him, and it stood up and ran away. And they both looked at each other about shit their pants and ran the opposite way.
Yeah.
And because they're just 15 years man. Old.
Correct.
A little leafish man. And that's what it reminded me of, was from the description of what they were talking about. And seeing that evidence of that little guy, you know, just little face and stuff, makes you wonder. I don't know. Maybe they've been around for a long time, been here, mm-hmm. and been around, you know. Well, they're just camouflaged.
Stay really tuned on that one. We'll keep you posted.
Well, if they do exist, I'm sure they've been around here for a long-ass time.
They would have to be. Unless they just got lucky. Sure. I always think about this, because there is this theory that if a race or a species was advanced enough to figure out interstellar travel or intergalactic travel, they would have to be so much more advanced in terms of years. But I don't know. Doesn't it seem like if they just happened upon better technology, like if they had had just a smarter Albert Einstein on their planet, maybe they could jump ahead And maybe they're not necessarily things that are 1,000 or 10,000 or 20,000 years old, but they're neck and neck with us, I guess. 1,000.
What if you were, like you said, what if they're just lucky and they came across some other technology that they didn't even
like that theory.
Build? You know,
like, hey, what do we got right here?
Yeah, hey, it works. Cool.
Oh,
let's
hello,
go fuck
Earth.
Around.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's a trip. That's
That'd be a
trip
funny comedy. Just some fucking alien on some dumbass, like a super stupid planet of just goobers out there in some galaxy, and then they somehow stumble upon some sort of technology or a craft that was crashed by somebody else. And
right.
They just climb into it. What do we got right here? And all of a sudden, they're the greatest race in the universe. Well, how about we get moving on to my little horror movie quote quiz here. I have high hopes for y'all. I think this will be fairly easy for most of you. If you're
Did you guys want to talk about the before that real fast? You guys want to talk about the fires and the conspiracy theory on that? The fires in Hawaii or not? Was it Kauai?
What's the theory on those fires?
Well, this is supposed to be this like conspiracy theory that anything that's painted a certain blue, a specific laser cannot burn it. And it's the only thing out of the whole color spectrum that doesn't burn, right? Well, apparently, like a lot of these resorts, they have like, they're completely obliterated. They're completely just fried. Except for like blue awnings, anything that had a blue awning on it. Tables that are set out within these resorts, mm-hmm. untouched. They're completely untouched. There's houses up in the hills that are all painted this blue, apparently. And they're completely untouched from this giant fire. What they suspect is that it's some kind of like space technology that was used to basically laser technology. So the lasers were coming from space that were frying all the land.
I was muted. You didn't hear me laugh.
Well, I'm not saying it has any truth
or
relevancy to it.
Okay,
so
let's say that the laser couldn't light blue on fire. Fire can light blue on fire. Once the fire was started, it seemed like it would burn an awning.
Well, if you were in space and you had a laser that could like jetty a net formation, and as you're going through, say, like a quarter mile at a time, and you're just spanning across the island, it would basically ignite everything that was on fire except that has that shade of blue. So if you have a house or a state that's in that color, the lasers wouldn't affect it. They would just basically skip your house, go on to the next and fry everything else. That's
right.
That's the theory.
What would be the point of it? What's the
giant land grab?
Why they did
land grab?
Okay, so
Well, right now, I guess Oprah Winfrey and The Rock has set up this big old fund, and they're
so
trying
got
to
lasers
ask money,
burning
ask
Hawaii,
money.
So The Rock and Oprah Winfrey can buy land. Is that
not
what the
necessarily?
Is?
Sense to me.
They opened up a help me thing to basically ask civilians and people to add money into it to help out as a program, but it was all put in their names and not in like any kind of a typical Red Cross or Blue Cross kind of deal. You know what I mean? And I'm just bringing it up for topic. I don't believe in it. I'm just saying.
Well, here's my thing, and I need to be heard here. Let's say that laser shooting, fire starting, or equipment shooting fire starting lasers from space is a real thing, and it can't fire upon blue for whatever reason. Once those lasers start a fire, the fire will burn indiscriminately. The laser may be color specific, but fire isn't. So I don't know how that theory could compute.
Well, it's under the theory, and they showed pictures of it where these like blue buildings are still standing around everything that's else is fried around it. But there's a good, couple acres in between,
I would suspect that if someone was doing some middle of the road research, they'd be able to find green awnings and green buildings and all sorts of shit that were burnt, were not totally destroyed. I don't know. I have not heard this one at all.
After the day I've had to entertain this bullshit as a fucking thought exercise.
Yeah, well, again, I stand on my theory that fire burns indiscriminately no matter what the color is. So even if the laser thing is true, and I've never heard that, doesn't mean it's not true. Once the fire started, it would burn. It would just burn whatever was there.
I would think it'd be a huge waste of resources to fucking burn a whole island down.
Well, yeah, just to make tracks of land for Oprah and The Rock.
Exactly.
We got some weird-ass conspiracy theories out there, man.
That's what you're coming to today.
I don't know how people have this much time on their fucking hands. I mean, even if you're not busy, like, with work or busy raising children or chasing a dream, we got video games, we got Netflix, we got new series and books coming out all the time. Like, how do we have so much time to come up with some of this shit? But anyway, well, I'm glad you brought it up. I'm going to look into it. Maybe we'll
give it some closure
on the next episode. But for now, let's get going with our horror movie quote quiz.
Number one, quotes or sound effects?
It's quote. I was going to do sound clips, but it just wasn't coming across. I'm just going to read you the clip or read you the quote. And I'm going to need you to have your phones handy because I don't want you all to be able to siphon off each other. Now, I got 11 questions here, I think, which sounds like a lot, and maybe it is. We'll just gauge the clock. But I think because we won't be analyzing these and we won't be talking about them ad nauseum, you're just going to answer straight to me, and I'm going to log it. I think we'll move through these pretty quickly. So, y'all got your phone?
Yep.
So
we're ready for this.
Sending a message just to me. What quote is this movie from? Get away from her, you bitch. Is it A, Army of Darkness? B, Texas Chainsaw Massacre? Or C, Alien? Chris, I'm going to let you answer again because you answered before the multiple choice and you were technically wrong.
Actually, I believe you have it wrong.
Oh, maybe I do. We'll see. Oh, you're right.
Oh.
Okay. Well, I'm going to give it to even if you're close here. Well, you have the choices. I would give you the one that was closest. Yeah, you're right, Chris. See, when I was playing that quote back in my head, I was picturing a very different scene that now...
I'm very fond of that
doesn't
movie.
Make sense. Okay. Well, John Mark said aliens. Lyle said alien. Christopher said aliens. And I believe that Christopher and John Mark are right. It's aliens. I got it wrong. Either way.
Well, I forgot the ask.
I'm giving it to you. Look, like I said, I feel like I made the last one too hard. So I'll give you, a heads up. There's not going to be a situation where it's like, is it A, alien? B, aliens?
Alien.
Three, yeah, it won't. There won't be anything like that. So if you get the franchise of it, I'm going to give it to you. All right. Sorry about that. You all got it right. Sorry about that, Chris. I told you were wrong.
No, it's all good.
Sarah and I were just talking about it. It's way overdue to at least watch Alien and Aliens. I used to watch Alien every year. Alien is one of the most important movies to me.
It's amazing how different those are.
A one-time filmmaker.
It's one of the greatest movies ever fucking made.
It's art. Yeah. It's start to finish art. Aliens is a totally different thing, but I love it just as much for different reasons.
One of the greatest movies ever fucking made.
Absolutely.
See, I feel unshakable like that movie duo. And I feel like Terminator 1 and 2 have a similar jump.
I agree.
Terminator 1 is almost a horror movie, and Terminator 2 is like an action thriller. But it's funny because it's the same director that took over for both of those. I think James Cameron actually did the first Terminator as well.
He did.
Yeah.
But that has such a different vibe. The second one, it's like he learned how to make. I'm not saying Terminator.
It was relatively low budget, that first Terminator. Yeah,
they filmed like Rogue. They had to, because they couldn't get permits. So they filmed at night on the street of the cities and stuff. Nuts.
And with
Ridley, you know, there's
Go ahead, Lon.
Well, I was going to say there's a game called Aliens, and that I've never ever finished playing. I started it and just never finished it. It's a weird game because it's kind of like Splinter Cell. It's all about stealth.
Oh, and Ron talked about this game. Oh, that's, Isolation, right?
Isolation.
Yeah.
That game is fucking amazing.
Yeah, no, that game. I've started it, but I've never finished it.
I watched Tyler LeBlanc play that every night for a week.
I don't got the patience.
Well, I don't got the patience because balls. I don't have any.
But Lyle's
guns,
right.
You know?
A lot of that game is like hiding in a locker. But that's what makes it awesome. Is like, oh, this is.
I did enough of that in my childhood. I don't need to fucking
reload. Get me out of this fucking closet. Okay, y'all aced question one. I think we're off to a good start. Question two. I'll get you, my pretty, and your little soul, too. Is it A, Hellraiser, B, Nightmare on Elm Street, or C, Phantasm? I'll get you, my pretty, and your little soul, too. I see everyone typing. Christopher weighed in, and he is correct. Lyle weighed in.
I was a little concerned.
And John Mark weighed in, and he's correct. So, Lyle said Phantasm. Good guess, and there is kind of a similar line in there. These won't all be that. well, I tried to make them like, so there's kind of a thing that happened in that movie.
Sure.
But no, John Mark and Christopher were both right with Nightmare on Elm Street. That was a classic Freddy line.
I don't remember Freddy ever calling anybody pretty.
My little pretty.
Oh, yeah.
It seems more of a wicked witch.
That also sounds like something that could be from one of the Evil Dead movies.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, we got some of that coming up. Let's move on to question three. What movie has this really famous quote? They're probably watching me. Well, let them. Let them see what kind of person I am. I'm not even going to swat that fly. Is it A, Psycho, B, Silence of the Lambs, or C, The Exorcist? They're probably watching me. Well, let them. Let them see what kind of person I am. I'm not even going to swat that fly. John Mark and Lyle both say Silence of the Lambs. I thought that might be a good one to sway you in the wrong direction, because it was, in fact, A, Psycho. That's when Norman has gone full into Mother. It's the very end of Psycho, and he's sitting in the cell. He's like, can I get a blanket, please? Thank you.
You know, that was my first instinct, but honestly, I don't know if I've ever actually watched that movie all the way through. Maybe one time, but...
Oh, my God. John Mark, you gotta... You know,
I know.
I watched Psycho fairly late. I think I was probably in my 30s. Honestly, like early 30s, but the first time I watched the original Psycho all the way through. I had seen Psycho 2, ironically, a couple of times, and I liked it when I was a kid, and I still like it. Psycho 2 is a really interesting sequel, considering... You know, Psycho... The original Psycho was in the 60s. Psycho 2 was like 1983, 1984. It's a pretty fun sequel. I recommend it. But good job, Chris. You are in the lead with 3. John Mark in second with 2. And Lyle in first with 1. You're all living up to your numbers. Let's see where we go from here. Number 4. What quote or what movie is this quote from? Barb, honey, we're dead. I don't think we have much to worry about anymore. Is it A, Night of the Living Dead, B, Beetlejuice, or C, Poltergeist 2?
Can you say the quote again one more time?
Barb, honey, we're dead. I don't think we have much to worry about anymore. The choices are A, Night of the Living Dead, B, Beetlejuice, or C, Poltergeist 2, sorry.
Better jazz?
Chris and Lyle weighed in here.
Better jazz?
Okay, I thought you would all get that. Of course, it is Beetlejuice. So, Lyle now has 2, Jean-Marc has 3, and Christopher has 4. Anybody's game. Mm-hmm. Plenty of questions left here. Okay. Probably getting a little trickier here, but not by much. Number 5 is Joanna, when we're free of this place, all the ghosts will go away. Is it A, Sweeney Todd, B, The Conjuring, or C, The Amityville Horror? The quote again is, Joanna, when we're free of this place, the ghosts will all go away.
Can you read them one more time?
Sweeney Todd, The Conjuring, or Amityville Horror? Very big clue.
Jesus, spell check.
Very big clue in the...
I don't know. I'm torn between two.
Interesting. Well, Christopher says The Conjuring. Jean-Marc says Amityville Horror. Lyle is correct with, I feel you, Joanna. Sweeney Todd. Yeah.
Wow.
The other two are the same story.
Not super familiar with that. I think I've watched the movie one time.
What?
The Conjuring and Amityville or whatever? They're the same story.
You guys have to fucking... You guys have got to see Sweeney Todd.
Yeah, Sweeney Todd's good.
Well, I went to the play that there was in Wenatchee, okay. But I also saw it.
That was a good... Time. I thought that was a pretty good version of it, honestly.
It was, but like it's just not something that like I'm super familiar with.
Okay. All right. Well, it's Halloween season coming up, so you guys should all watch Sweeney Todd if you haven't seen it. But good job, Lyle. You're now tied with Christopher. 4-4, and Jean-Marc just barely behind with 3. Okay. Another classic. Come on up to the slab. Oh, sorry. Come on up to the lab and see what's on the slab. Let me do that again. I botched it. The quote is, come on up to the lab and see what's on the slab. Is it A, Sleepwalkers, B, The Rocky Horror Picture Show, or C, Frankenstein? Come on up to the lab and see what's on the slab.
Going into the lab one night.
Lyle guessed Frankenstein.
I can't what? Spell. No, I know. The phone doesn't.
But that's such a good misspell. Not correct. However, Christopher and Jean-Marc are both correct with Rocky Horror Picture Show, which puts them. Puts them both at a tie for 5.
Another one, which I'm pretty sure that I've probably seen, but I don't actually remember watching the whole thing.
Oh, wow. It's a fucking fun movie for its time. Too. Like, it's Tim not. Curry?
Especially for its time. It's like, wow, these are some bold motherfuckers.
This is brave.
That was on Broadway.
Brave. And people loved it.
Yeah. Still do. It's good shit. Great fucking soundtrack. All right, moving on. So we,
what was that? It sounded like a clown horn in the background.
I thought that was you.
No, it was my chair squeaking.
Oh. I thought that was Lyle's sound effect. All right, so Jean-Marc and Christopher are tied at 5. Lyle right behind. You guys are kicking ass. Lyle's right behind with 4. Moving on to question 7. Words of wisdom, Lloyd, my man. Words of wisdom.
Sorry, can you say it one more time?
Words of wisdom, Lloyd, my man. Words of wisdom. Is it A, The Thing, B, The Shining, or C, Tremors? Words of wisdom, Lloyd, my man.
That's great.
Words of wisdom.
Wow. Great polls here.
Thank you.
Where it makes me really, like, I'm like, oh, that's definitely, oh, wait a second.
can you go through the multiple choice real quick?
Yeah, is it The Thing, The Shining, okay, or Tremors? All right. Lyle says The Thing. Christopher says Tremors. Jean-Marc got it correct. It was The Shining. It was Lloyd, the bartender. Yeah.
Bartender?
That's where I was going at first, and I was like, damn, that really does sound like a Tremors quote.
That's amazing that Tremors is what pulled you. Okay. Yeah, Lloyd does sound like a Tremors name. Is there a Lloyd in Tremors?
That was good. That was good because that literally could have been from all three of those movies.
Yeah, it sounded
it was good. I
appreciate that. All right.
You son of a bitch.
John Mark is now in the lead with 6.
Wait a sec. Weren't me and Lyle tied a moment ago?
No,
you and John Mark were... Well, you and Lyle were tied at first, and then John Mark got ahead of you, and then... Hey, look. Prove me wrong. Listen back next week and prove me wrong. I've been writing them down as you guys have been sending them to me. But, Chris, you're only in second by one. So it's anybody's game. And John Mark is the only one that got... I'm looking backwards. Yeah, everything looks right.
Didn't I get Rocky Horror right and John Mark got it too?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he's ahead of you by one. You both got the last one wrong. He got The Shining.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, number 8. Sometimes dead is better. Is it A, The Evil Dead? B, Return of the Living Dead? Or C, Pet Sematary? Sometimes dead is better. Got John Mark and Christopher in here.
There's another quote from this movie you have occasionally done over the years.
Yes, there is. I couldn't possibly go that easy.
I'm going to have to hear.
But apparently this was easy enough because you all three got Pet Sematary. And that
did they spell it right too, like I did?
Lyle didn't. John Mark's typing again.
Mine was spell check. So
John Mark just said pet, but I accepted. Oh, he just sent cemetery with an S. And you don't want to go down that road. It's those goddamn trucks. Yeah, classic.
You can't get from here to there.
There it is. Okay, so now Lyle has 5, John Mark has 7, Christopher has 6. Good, close game. Just a few more here. Number 9. Listen to them. Children of the Night. What music they make.
What beautiful music they make.
Is it A, Dracula? B, The Wolfman? Or C, The Mummy? Listen to them, Children of the Night. What music they make. Lyle and John Mark have weighed in.
Listen to them.
Christopher has weighed in. You are all correct with Dracula. Of course, one of the most memorable Dracula quotes. Okay, so Lyle has 6. He can't catch up at this point, but a damn fine effort. John Mark is still in the lead with 8, and Christopher is right behind with 7. So these last two questions are going to be the deciding factor here, I imagine. I guess if Lyle gets both of those right. Well, no, John Mark will still beat. Okay.
Well, they got it.
Question 10. I'm your friend till the end. Is it A, Dolls? B, The Puppet Master? Or C, Child's Play?
Well, Lyle, are you scared on this one, buddy?
Yeah, no.
No matter which way you go, we got a problem.
Yeah, and I don't know. Dolls don't really affect me that much. They're the porcelain ones, anyway. The old-timey porcelain ones with the eyes that open up at you.
Mm-hmm. Well, nothing was decided on that round because you all got Child's Play.
Whiffed it?
Okay. Last question. I don't think we'll probably... I guess we couldn't possibly need a tiebreaker. Well, maybe. We'll see. Last question. You're doomed. You're all doomed. Is it A, Friday the 13th? B, Poltergeist? C, The Sixth Sense? It's hard to say. You're doomed.
Whoa.
You're all doomed.
What was the first one?
Friday the 13th. B is Poltergeist. and C is the Sixth Sense. Interesting.
I'm going to change my mind. I'm sorry.
Okay.
You're doomed. You're all doomed.
I think I hope I didn't just deviate from the right answer. We'll see. I was confusing one of those movies for another one.
Okay. Well, Jean-Marc, you sent me something, but are you? I gave Chris another chance. Are you locking in the one you sent? Okay. Jean-Marc said Poultrygeist. Another classic film.
Poultry gobble gobble geist?
Lyle also said Poultrygeist. Now I can't stop saying Poultrygeist. Chris originally said Poltergeist, but he wisely changed his answer to Friday the 13th.
Now, this was one of the, I'm coming for you.
This was a good switcheroo that I was proud of, because there's a scene in Poltergeist where that old creepy dude is like, "You're all gonna die in there," you know. Mm-hmm. That was the reason I
was imagining the psychic saying, "You're doomed. You're all or something."
Mm-hmm. Well, let me come up with a tiebreaker, because I didn't have one planned. I'm going to, let's see.
Do literally any quote from Return of the Living Dead.
Disqualified.
Couldn't possibly be fair.
Collusion.
I left it out for a reason. Let's see. Let me think of a... instead of doing just another quiz, I think Chris's tiebreakers are the best. Let's go with the numbers one. You guys don't look this up. In fact, I'm not going to say it out loud just yet.
Don't do your voice to search, okay?
Wow, it's that answer?
So hey, Siri.
So, gang.
Orange bungee cord. Now we're
all... Yeah, orange bungee. Okay, here we go. So, interesting. I just brought this up. It Chapter 1 is the highest grossing horror film of all time. I feel like this might have even been something that Christopher brought on one of these rounds of elimination.
Disqualified.
So text me your answer. Closest wins. Doesn't
What's
have
the
to
question?
Be,
how much did it gross?
How much did It Chapter 1 gross altogether?
Gross. That's gross.
Chapter 1?
Closest wins.
We all float down here, Bailey.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I'm totally taking a guess.
Yeah, we have to.
I'm not, because I'm not in the die, so.
Yeah, John Mark. Got Christopher's. So, John Mark says 250 million. Christopher said 550 million. You are both well shy, but Christopher is closest with $750 million.
Wow.
That's three quarters of $1 billion to go see a clown torment children.
That was a good movie.
We're a weird society. All right. Well, that was
fun. That was fun.
Yeah.
You earned it.
Thanks, man. I'll take that victory over you.
Yeah, you guys.
Now you just have to destroy my quiz, Jean-Marc.
Y'all did well. Yeah. Now let's take a quick break and then let's do a quiz.
All right, let's do it.
All right.
Well, I would love to just dive right into this. I'm fucking prepared. I'm ready. I've got some great questions. I just can't do it until we get through one step, Ron. One small step for podcast kind.
Well,
one giant step for Ron.
Joke's on you, because I had it ready, motherfucker.
Poop thing.
Nature.
Brown hair.
Weird Christopher.
Oh, yeah. Doesn't happen very often, but I did think about it ahead of time.
But feels good to be back, guys. Mm-hmm. Feels good to be back.
It does.
Had some fun writing this today. Let's get right down to it. Question one. Variety reported this week that USA Today has opened a special position and has begun to look for a writer whose sole responsibility at USA Today is going to be to report on this. It's their beat. That's all they're going to report on. Is it A, TikTok trends?
Okay.
Is it B, the writer and actor strike?
Oh, yeah, that's been interesting.
Is it C, Taylor Swift?
Sign me up.
Or D, UFO-related news and sightings?
Nice.
Again, okay. USA Today is looking for a writer whose sole purpose is going to be to cover one of these. TikTok trends, the writer and actor strike, Taylor Swift, or UFO-related news and sightings. Ronster.
Boy, a couple herrings here. I feel like the T-Swift herring is the swifter part of the river, pulling me under toward it. But the UFO, there's been a lot of talk of UFOs lately, as we just mentioned. I don't think they'd have to try too hard to find someone to cover T-Swift, but I'm going to go with the UFOs.
UFOs. I'll put you down for D.
What a job, huh?
John Mark.
Any of them.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with Tay-Tay.
Oh, Tadoff Swindler.
Damn it.
Swindler. She's hot. Hot to trot.
She is.
I just can't imagine what it'd be about, like her boyfriends and how she breaks up with her boyfriends and writes songs about them. I don't know. Her
fucking insane career. Listen, speaking of TikTok, I'm sorry, I'm interrupting here, but a brief aside. I have one of my favorite things about the live stream TikToks I've been coming across lately is people live streaming the concerts that they're at. There's just even like up in the nosebleeds. It's an experience. And, you know, our phones are getting so good at being able to decipher that much loudness that it sounds pretty good. And if someone's got a fairly stable hand, you can watch that show in real time. And I watched a little bit of Taylor Swift. Well, I've watched a ton. I watched the Maiden, the most recent Maiden stuff, Def Leppard concert, Smashing Pumpkins.
Def Leppard.
But I saw Taylor Swift's show, and it was an amazing fucking show. I checked in. Yeah. You know, I didn't sit there and watch it the whole time, but I went back to it a couple of times. Like, man, this is a full-on fucking show. And she's got, like, amazing sets and effects, and so it was an interesting thing. I've been enjoying that aspect of TikTok, but
That's the only content I could think of that would be newsworthy enough to bring a daily thing would be TikTok.
I actually fell asleep watching a live stream of a King Gizzard show last year.
Wow.
Like,
you old man.
I was like, King Gizzard, I'm about to go to bed. Oh, King Gizzard's streaming a live show. I'm gonna fucking put that on and just...
So you're going with the TikTok trends?
Yeah, just okay, because cool. It seems to me like it's the only thing that has enough content to actually have a stable thing. But I mean, God, there's got to be some kind of weird liability to that, because you're basically rebroadcasting somebody else's shit.
Oh, the live stream concerts. I don't know how.
I'm talking about just in general, like the news and stuff. I don't know what if you could do it legally. You know what I mean? It's like somebody taking snippets off our podcast and making profit off of it. You know, I don't know if it's legally bounding.
Sometimes the bands you can do it. And that was actually the King Gizzard show that I fell asleep to, was they were broadcasting it live themselves from somebody's cell phone. I don't know who it was, but
yeah. What I'm saying has nothing to do with bands or live concerts. What I'm saying is the content of, you know, the TikTok to be able to have a news outlet strictly based on that. I don't know the legality of it. If it's
it would be fair use. If you're reporting on it, you can do a little clip of it.
Reporting on anything is pretty much fair game. So.
Yeah, it's freedom of speech. So,
all right. Where are we at here?
Let's see. Okay, we're moving on to the next question here. Man, I read this and I was so fucking tickled by it, I had to turn it into a question. Question two. On the very last day of the filming of the movie The Titanic, something kind of remarkable happened. What happened? So I'm going to read you four things, and per usual, I've made up three. One is correct. Was it A, James Cameron gifted every crew member with a Rolex watch, and yes, they were waterproof?
Okay.
Is it B, Leonardo DiCaprio dropped 40 plus F-bombs in a single rant about having to share a dressing room with Kate Winslet?
Who would complain about that?
Did he paint her like his naked girls? Naked French girls?
Dress and undress next to Kate any old day. Yeah. And Leo, for that matter.
Does it see? Someone pooped in the tank of water the actors floated in, and it was caught on camera, and extensive reshoots were required.
No. Yeah. That's just the way you said that. Someone pooped.
Poop things, man.
Poop things in nature.
Yeah, we all know how I'm going to answer, I think. But let's hear D.
You already know what the brown hair is.
My number D might get you around.
Yeah, okay.
Or D. Eddie Money. No.
Eddie Money showed up to the set.
Eddie Money.
I've got 2 tickets to the steam train. Okay.
Blue.
Someone, is it D? Someone laced
the craft services. If I could walk on water. That would have been a better poll. I mean, come on.
Paddle me home tonight. Is it D? Someone laced the craft services food with LSD, causing 80-plus cast members to hallucinate, including James Cameron.
Wow. That's got to be a crime.
Yeah, that would be a crime.
Again, on the very last day of the filming of the movie Titanic, something remarkable happened. Was it James Cameron gifted every crew member with a waterproof Rolex watch? Leonardo DiCaprio dropped 40 F-bombs in a rant about sharing a dressing room. Someone pooped in the tank of water the actors were filming in, and they had to do extensive reshoots. Or someone laced craft services food with LSD, causing 80-plus cast members to hallucinate, including James Cameron himself. Ronster.
Wow. Well, you're right. I am torn between the poop and the LSD. caught on camera. I feel like that would have popped up. That's
your
my only caveat.
Your Titanic
like,
DVD?
Wow, we would have.
Right?
I feel like I would have seen that footage. I feel like there's one piece of footage that I would have stopped to watch. It's a Titanic film tank.
The DVDs, the grooves are worn out in the DVD.
Being pooped into. Yeah.
I like the triple VHS box set.
Yeah, the triple. Box was a brown water edition.
Exactly.
Oh my God. I'm sorry. Give me A and B one more time.
James Cameron gifted every crew member with a waterproof Rolex was A, or the Leo dropping 40 F-bombs about having to share a dressing room with Winslet.
Oh, I feel like it's got to be C or D. I'm going to go with D only because I have not seen footage of poop-related tomfoolery of a 1999 film, 98 or 99, somewhere around there, and I feel like I would have. One of the biggest films of all time. I feel like Ron W. Evans would have found his way to that poop footage.
So you want to go with C then, right?
Poop bird, straight ahead.
I want to go with someone laced.
Pooped? Oh, you're going with the LSD.
Shit, with LSD.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's a good answer. They're all good answers.
Yeah. Okay. John Mark.
Well, there's definitely a brown herring in this particular edition of the weird trivia.
Brown herring.
I'm going with
the Shitanic.
Going with LSD.
You're going with LSD too. Yes. Okay.
No love for Shitanic.
You down for a D.
I don't know about that. I just because it's like back then it would be manslaughter charges for each one.
My
so
fart will go
whoever
on.
If they were caught.
True.
Did you guys like Titanic? I feel like this just came up. Did you guys like Titanic when it came out?
Yeah,
I didn't mind it.
I liked it.
Or 16.
I thought it was great.
I didn't watch it for fucking years. I refused to fucking watch it.
Yeah, well, good. That's
all right.
I liked it.
I haven't seen it in 10 years, so I don't.
I'll tell you what. I think when I found it, and I'm not kidding about the 3 fucking VHS box set. I was in Plain, Washington, and it's in the middle of fucking nowhere. Mm-hmm. And I was working, and I hadn't seen the movie, and it's already, you know, been in the theater, gone, you know. You'd be lucky to find it at Blockbuster if you're lucky. And I was in there in some rural little fucking grocery store, and it was just staring at me. Just buy me, you know, $10. Buy me. I'm used. And
buy
so
me,
I was
baby.
Like, you know what?
Pay me like one of your French girls, Lyle.
It was Friday, and I felt like painting her like amused. A little French girl. And I took her
painted it, too.
White. And I took her home, and I put her
Jackson
with the rest
Pollock.
Of my...
mm-hmm.
rest of my VHS collection, and I watched it probably a year late, you know, but it was, I thought it was really good.
That's good.
It was long, you know, but
you still got it? You still got it? Is it all...
I actually still have it. All my movies are packed. They're all packed up in boxes, but yeah.
Well, I still have my VHS. Worth money.
Where I was at that time in my life, I refused to watch it on principle, but I eventually watched it.
Doesn't surprise me.
Years later, and I was like, it's okay. But I did eventually cave and watch it. But, yeah, you know.
It's sappy, and you know, sure. But yeah. At the time, I thought it was a pretty interesting epic tale, and it did make you appreciate what actually happened. To me, it made you appreciate.
Agree. It did have some mind blowing special effects.
Yeah, there's some great effects at the time, and some really fucking tough scenes to get
too,
through.
Even those Jesus.
I can still hear the guy bouncing off that fucking thing as he falls. A clang! As he's like, you know what I'm talking about?
I just saw a meme, and the Oscar goes to... I don't remember what the meme exactly was.
That
but
brought
the...
back some really unpleasant memories for me from something I experienced in real life.
Wow.
Seeing someone fall onto a propeller?
Okay, so there's a bunch of us that took some LSD to... Funnily enough,
we were working on the set of the Titanic at the time. It was very bizarre.
We decided,
and
to
we
give
all
it
ended
all
up
cast.
At Gasworks Parks. At Gasworks Park.
Oh, you told us some story.
Yeah,
I
remember this.
And right. There was
you're at a job site or something.
We were all just kind of chilling, and there was another group. Some people from our group went into they climbed the fence and went into the structures and were like fucking around in there. And there was another group of people that were in there. And they were like, hey, how's it going? We're going to come over and meet you. And then, one of the people fell through. Like, there was a section of a catwalk that wasn't there. And he just fell 40 fucking feet.
God.
And we heard him like banging off the sides of the fucking shit, all the way down. Yeah, exactly. And hit the ground. And it was 30 seconds later, he was like, because when it had been knocked out of him, it was like, oh my God, is he dead? What the fuck? It was, So, anyways, good times.
He didn't die, though, right?
No, he didn't. I mean, actually,
well, get the fuck over it, Gemma.
We had
laughed at the dude hitting the fucking propeller.
We had found out that apparently he had been under some studies at at Swedish Medical Hospital for some other shit had happened to him. They're trying to figure out why he had such powers of rehabilitation. I mean, he was walking with a cane when I saw him, but it was fucking crazy.
They did studies on him, how are you not dead?
Exactly, yeah, yeah, totally.
Yeah, that's got to be pretty surreal, hearing somebody literally ringing bells as they're falling down,
It was fucking nuts.
I mean, if you really think about it, it was a pretty crass scene, because... I remember everyone in the theater laughing at the guy. Ah, boom.
No way, really?
No more yelling. Yeah.
No, that guy's dead.
It was hard. It was but that goes all the way back to King Kong. Remember the scenes?
That shit happens in real life, man.
The scenes of people falling, they're like, as soon as they hit their head. Boop,
here's the question. I mean, if you were there on the Titanic, would you rather fucking take a head? Fucking hit to the head and be dead, or you rather drown in the fucking cold icy water?
I'd be in that stern, fucking someone else's stern, and being like, "Look, we got 30 seconds by my measure." Now,
before the cold makes my
wieners. There's no way I'm
off.
Pulling wood when I'm pulling water. Those two elements don't compute. But you like to think that you're going down. You know?
Going down.
Probably almost never works
that
way. One of the cutest scenes, though.
I need your answers.
Okay, we'll move on.
My answer is, did you hear about the conspiracy? There actually is a conspiracy about the Titanic.
Of course there is.
Was it actually
lasered? Called the Olympic? And what they did was they basically swapped the names of the boats because the Olympic was actually destined to fail. And they had so much money put into it that it would pay off both, and they were kind of hurting for money. So what they did is they swapped the names out, and they put the Olympic out there, and the Olympic was actually The one that sunk.
Very similar to this show I watched on Netflix called 1899 or some shit like that.
Is it? Because I don't know. I heard it in conversation just the other day. Yeah. I wasn't like believing it or anything. But I'm gonna go with. I'm gonna say that they had enough money, and obviously it did because of what they did. Phenomenal job on the movie. I'm gonna say that he gave the cast. I'm not saying like 200 people Rolexes, but at least a handful of the head stars Rolexes.
200 Rolexes is tit money from
easy
James Cameron.
That's nothing. That's memorable money. Thanks for being on the show. Here you go. Mm-hmm. Nice. Yeah.
All right. I like it. All right. Question three. I was watching some old Star Wars news clips the other day. To no one's surprise, I'm sure. I learned something interesting about Carrie Fisher. I'm going to read you four things about Carrie. Only one of them is true. The others I made up. What's true? Is it A? Carrie Fisher was fluent in French. Okay. Is it B? She once was a bouncer for a popular LA bar.
Damn right. Get out of here.
Is it C? She served 2 years in the U.S. military before becoming an actor.
There he is, sir.
Or is it D? See, she absolutely fucking hated science fiction films and was certain Star Wars would flop.
Well, that sounds more like Harrison Ford. That doesn't mean that... Well, Carrie Fisher came from a very interesting background, of course. Both famous parents, Eddie Fisher and... help me out. Her mom... The dancer, actress. You guys don't know their mom's name either? It's so funny how the brain shit tends to be universal. John Mark, you got to know the Debbie
Harris. Oh
my God. Reynolds? No.
Debbie Reynolds.
Reynolds?
Yeah. There you go.
Harris? Reynolds?
Reynolds. Yeah. Debbie Reynolds.
Reynolds. Good. Yeah,
Debbie Reynolds and Eddie Fisher.
The day I've had. Oh my God, my brain is like a fucking pile of mush. Seriously.
Well, so hearing that she would speak French, was that the...
Mm-hmm. Fluent in French.
Fluent in French. Wouldn't surprise me at all. Famous folks that probably hung out in France. I'm sorry, real quick, the rest of the answers.
Yeah. Fluent in French, bouncer for a popular LA bar for a bit. 2 years in the military before becoming an actress, or hated sci-fi and with certain Star Wars would flop.
Boy, I'm tempted to go with the Ford Harrington, but I'm gonna stick with French. I feel like, knowing what I know about her parents, they seemed very artistic, and everything of that era
traveled
and
well educated.
Yeah, dance in France and all that shit. Mm-hmm, absolutely, she would have been around to at least pick up some of that. I mean, I'm guessing she could have learned French in L.A. All I know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll go with that.
Okay, John Mark.
All of these seem legit, but I fucking have no idea, and I'm surprised. So I'm just gonna go with D.
Okay, I'll put you down for she hated sci-fi and thought it would flop.
That makes sense too, because can you name one other sci-fi that she was ever in? I can't say there isn't, but everything else she did was like sitcom or like rom-coms and dramas. I can't think of any other drama.
Aside from the Star Wars films, especially at that time, right?
Yeah, that's a good guess too.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with the French thing too. Oui, oui.
Oui, oui, oui. Oui, oui. Down for French.
My ding, ding, dong. She loved my ding, ding, my ding, ding, dong.
I still think. Oh my. Carrie Fisher. In her prime, is one of the most beautiful human beings that ever lived and ever will. Do you guys agree?
Yeah, she was very beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah.
She
seemed like a remarkable woman.
Special.
Yeah.
Special kind of beauty.
I'd like to read her book. She has like a book out, an autobiography. I'd like to read it. Okay.
I would too.
Question four.
Because she ended up not in a good life. Yeah.
Yeah. I love this one too. Alan Jackson
blew up in the early 90s as one of America's favorite country artists.
Don't he rock was invited... the jukebox.
Uh-huh, there we go.
I think that's
he was invited to perform his hit Gone Country for the 1994 ACM Awards. But after Gone he learned country. his band would be playing their instruments silently to a backup track they would pre-record, he did this during his live performance. And I do have video. Is it A?
Great.
He sang mostly gibberish into the microphone.
Yeah. That's the classic. B,
he asked his drummer to play air drums with no drumsticks.
Yeah. All right.
Is it C? He had mannequins placed on stage holding instruments. Or is it D? He had Metallica, whom he'd struck a friendship up with, sit in and play as his backing band.
Oh, country. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The head banging back there. Look at that. All right, again. Boy. Alan Jackson was asked to perform his hit song, Gone Country, for the 1994 ACM Awards. But after he learned his band would be playing their instruments to a pre-recorded backup track, he did this during his live performance. Sang gibberish. Asked his drummer to play air drums with no drumsticks, mannequins, or Metallica. Ronster.
There is something so familiar about the drumstick thing, but I'm associating that with a completely different band. I mean, gibberish is the obvious way to go, but the Metallica thing would be interesting. I'm going to go with the drumsticks thing just because there's something familiar about it in my head. But I feel like I know that. I feel like I just saw video of this story, but it was a different band. Anyway, I'm gonna go with drumsticks.
Okay,
feigning drums.
John Mark
feigning playing the drums, and, but everything totally else is great.
Outside.
It'd be amazing.
This is outside totally of your area. Outside of my wheelhouse, but so I have no fucking clue. Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna go with the mannequins.
Alan Jackson was a bit of a rock and roller country guy. It's 5 o'clock somewhere. You know, that it's country music, but isn't that Alan Jackson?
Yeah, still, like I said, out of my wheelhouse.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's Alan Jackson.
No, it's not. That's
5 o'clock somewhere.
That's Stepped on a Pop Top. Duh, buh, buh, duh, buh.
No, that's Jimmy Buffett. It's 5 o'clock somewhere. Rub, definitely. Dub, dub. I'm looking up.
5 o'clock somewhere. No, I don't know. I'm gonna go with John's Mark answer. I think it's more of a LA kind of a scene. It's an award show, so maybe just propped up, you know, a bunch of mannequins on there. And, you know, because he's kind of like the main eye candy of the stage anyway.
It's sure, 5 o'clock somewhere.
Man. All right, let's go over this quiz and see what happened here.
That was right.
It's
fucking Jimmy Buffett.
What's that?
How did I get that?
Jimmy Buffett, yeah, that's who I was thinking of.
I thought that was... wait. Oh, it's Alan Jackson, and no. Jimmy Buffett. We're both right.
Yeah. No, okay. He did a bunch of...
they sing it together.
He's like... He's not like Garth Brooks, but, I mean, he's got a shit ton of, like, really good songs.
All right. Rare Alan both Jackson. Being right. Okay. It's 5 o'clock
question
somewhere.
Question one, Variety...
R.I.P. both of them.
Yeah. Question one. Variety reported this week that USA Today is hoping to a special position for a person to write stories for them, and their sole purpose is going to be covering stories about Taylor Swift.
Oh, fucking hell.
There's that much Taylor
did
Swift
I go with
happening.
That?
No, you didn't.
No, I went with
she's
went
a pretty
UFO.
Private person, though, isn't she, in, like, real life? She doesn't, like, really...
Yeah, but she's doing so much publicly that, like, there's a new story about her every single day, seemingly. Like, the tour this...
No, that would definitely compute to be a full-time job.
Wow.
Yeah. What did I go with?
You went with UFO sightings and related news.
That was a good thing.
Okay, John Mark, off to a strong start with a point here. Question two, on the very last day of the filming, the movie The Titanic, somebody laced the craft services food with LSD, causing 80-plus people to hallucinate, including James Cameron and Bill Paxton. They both got sick. Megs had to come. They never found out who did this.
Wow,
and
wow.
I never saw this story until just recently. I was like, holy shit. Can you imagine?
I can.
No, I mean, like, I'm not, Jesus. Yeah.
That's, well, that's pretty fucked up.
Well, like, it's not that unheard of in that time, you know, that time era.
Well, It's poisoning.
It wasn't.
It's
it
lacing.
Wasn't demonized. You know.
I mean that's pretty intense. Like dosing, like on a movie that big. Fucking. Yeah, like,
you don't know. If you don't know that you have been given a hallucinogen, that is cruel and could that could send somebody down a really fucking terrifying place.
I would never give someone like mushrooms or something without them knowing, because it's even an edible, like if they're not used to it,
like,
you know,
oh, it's just a regular gummy
edible. I just wouldn't do it.
Yeah,
that's so fucked. People don't know how to handle that kind of high.
I had a friend of mine lace somebody's like soda pop with a. Hit acid once in like junior high.
It was so fucked up.
Watched him run around. No, I wouldn't do it. I never did it, and I wasn't part of it. Yeah. But like, I knew of people that would do shit like that. It's
I
like,
don't know. You fed me some cookies. Cruncer.
It's me, life. I'm the drugger. It's me. I dropped some LSD inside your little soda pop can. Yeah. No.
It's you. High. You were high. It's you. All right. I was watching some old Star Wars clips the other day, and I learned something interesting about Carrie Fisher. And I'm just going to go ahead and send a little video over to y'all. Ronster, pull that up to the microphone and let the people hear.
All right. Over Messenger.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Oh, she's so fucking cute. Cutest fucking face, man. All right, hit and play. Oh, I think we know where this is going.
Oui, il a écrit le script de Star Wars aussi, et il a fait les caractères pour tout.
Pretty impressive.
Yeah. Only more attractive.
I know, she only gets cuter, right?
I don't mean to be doing the
Okay.
Game.
Our princess.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, our princess. Ronster and Lyle got that correct for a point of pop, which I believe, let's see, that puts, so John Mark got 2 points, Ron has 2 points, Lyle has one. As we move on to our final question, Alan Jackson, motherfucking Alan Jackson blew up in the early 90s.
Old
and
country.
He was invited to play that very song, Lyle, for his the 1994 ACM Awards. Learned his band would be not playing live, but pre-recording their music, and he thought that was kind of bullshit. So here's the video, Ronster. Let's see if you can spot what happens. And it's, you only really need to watch about a minute and a half of this. I mean, that sounds like a lot, but man.
Okay. Old Reba introducing us.
Friendly superstar and now award show host. Ladies and gentlemen, here he is, Alan Jackson.
I see it. That is funny.
Just keep watching.
The drummer ain't playing with no sticks. But everything else looks normal. It's so subtle.
It's so subtle.
And yet, that's awesome.
Let him get to the chorus. It's so good.
Okay. Everyone else looks to be playing. Oh, I love that he's actually playing it. How could you not?
He is, right?
You'd have to.
Isn't that great? Which makes Ronster coming in clutch at the end.
Wow.
For another point in question four. Congratulations, Ron. Enjoy that victory.
And then he
sings it, sir.
Oh, my God. It just keeps going. How did the camera so person great. Not figure that out and just avoid the fuck out of the drummer?
It just tells
well,
you, like,
you know,
right. I almost sent you this video before I read the question. I wanted to see if you guys could, like, remember what, like, but I couldn't come up with enough questions that were subtle enough. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you would have known if Metallica was back there or if it was fucking dummies.
It does
I don't
get
think
better and better.
If you make someone watch that video, do you notice that he doesn't have drumsticks? Do you know what I mean?
Well, yeah. I mean, if you
don't
were going to do
I would.
A show, if you're going to do a show and you're going to do it and you're faking everything. Mm-hmm. You would kind of have to fake the drums because drums are loud, dude. You can't
I think
just
you're
like
right,
not.
I've seen John Mark try to do it, and when Ron was like, "I need you to play it like 70% volume."
Oh well, yeah. I mean, if you just barely,
yeah, it's really hard. Like,
man, what are you, Kurt Cobain or something?
Yeah, it's,
you got it.
It's super hard.
You got it, boss. We just turn it down. Oh man, well done, Ron. That was a fun one, huh?
Yeah, that was a fun one, and I could watch that shit all day. So, did this just come out? Are people just now noticing this, or was it a story that?
I just saw it pop up in like a trivia thing I follow.
I guess that must have been one I saw, but I thought it was something else. But that's hilarious. That's
great.
Yeah. and then he's also singing like harmonies on the mic. So he's air drumming and singing. That's good shit. Don't rock the jukebox. All right. Well, that was good shit. And I think on that note, we should get out of here because I think, ironically, even though 9/11 was yesterday, we're going to be talking about it next week.
By my measure.
Mm. Uh-huh. And I hear that caused by lasers. That's why nothing that was blue.
We got the documentation.
We have the documents. They're shooting lasers down at things. And if you want to protect your house or your loved ones in your church, you're going to need to paint it blue.
There's got to be a Christ.
It's blue.
Not too bright, not too dark.
A lot of people don't realize.
Sounds a little bit like sassy.
The blood of Christ is blue. So that's just. Yeah, I am going kind of going to sassy. Lasers. All right, y'all. I'll tune in next week. Thanks for tolerating our absences whenever they come up. And just keep on tuning in. The numbers don't drop somehow, even when we miss 3 weeks in a row.
We will still be here. We promise. We will
still be here.
Next time we'll talk about my birthday, which is tomorrow.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. Happy birthday to me yesterday.
Happy early birthday, buddy.
Birthday to Lyle.
Mine's going
to
be sitting in dialysis for the fucking 6 year in a row.
Well, listen, Lyle, we're happy you have a birthday at all. And I know that you are too after what you've gone through. So cheers to that. And after all, it is 5 o'clock somewhere.
Somewhere.
Rip Alan Jackson and Jimmy Buffett. All right, y'all. Tune in next week. 9/11.
Good night. Night, guys.
Good night.
Gone country.
Look at Ash.
So funny. I'll try to remember to post these videos under the event thing, sure. But don't feel bad reminding me.
Yeah. All right.
Good night, guys. I would make a giant ass maze out of salt and see if it could find its way out.
The reverse. The
good luck, fucker. Christopher Sociopath Hart will be upstairs smoking dubs.